Well, good morning, and thank you, Cindy, very much. And thank you to all of our partners who are here today. We are so fortunate to have such strong, supportive business community in Dakota County that works so well together. The resources and networking opportunities the chambers provide to local businesses are invaluable. Private businesses are the engine of our local economy. Your hard work and services support our county's healthy and growing economy. Before I begin today, I'd like to introduce my colleagues on the county board, starting with 2nd District Commissioner Kathleen Gaylord. Third District Commissioner Tom Egan. Fourth District Commissioner Joe Atkins. Fifth District Commissioner Liz Workman. 6th District Commissioner Mary Liz Holberg in the back. And 7th District Commissioner Chris Gerlach. Though he introduced himself, I also would like to once again introduce our County Attorney Jim Backstrom. And then Sheriff Tim Leslie is not able to be here today, but his Chief Deputy Joe Lako is here, so I'd like to acknowledge him as well in the back there. It's my privilege and to have the opportunity to share with you some of the great work the county has done recently and highlight some of the major future projects that are going on in Dakota County. I would be remiss to not acknowledge the great partnerships we have with so many nonprofits, cities, and volunteers. I would like to start by providing some of the feedback we gathered from residents as part of our 2016 residential survey. Every 3 years, we do a residential survey to understand the needs of our residents and provide efficient, cost-effective services that are very important to all of us. It was encouraging to hear that 95% of residents surveyed rated their quality of life in Dakota County very high. Our quality of life ratings were higher than the benchmark compared to other counties across the nation. Residents applauded the variety of services we offer and rated the economic health of the county as a positive to living here. A lot of work we do is to ensure our residents have a high quality of life. Seeing the positive results from the survey reinforces the work we are doing that will truly make the difference for all. Residents are able to enjoy such high quality of life here due to the hundreds of services provided by the county. Providing services that are efficient and effective is our mission. It's something we strive to do each and every day. Providing efficient services has again allowed us to maintain the lowest property tax levy per capita in the state of Minnesota, which we have accomplished for a number of years. I'm proud to say we also have the lowest levy per household in the state for 2017. Residents pay an average household levy of $834 compared to the metro average of $1,295. This means a typical family saves hundreds of dollars on county services in Dakota County compared to the other counties in the area. Reliably low county property taxes makes it easier for businesses to invest with confidence and bring jobs to Dakota County. Hard work by a lot of great people allows us to maximize efficiency while providing high quality services. In 2016, we also retired all of our outstanding debt that is supported by property taxes, something that is very unique throughout all of Minnesota. Our 2017 operating budget, totaling more than $246 million, ensures we can continue to provide quality services in the face of demand pressures. It is respectful to taxpayers while keeping financially disciplined for the long term. We feel a great responsibility to be good stewards of your tax dollars. We know it's your hard-earned money, and we take care of it using it carefully to keep communities safe, provide amenities and public assistance programs, maintain our roads, build infrastructure, promote economic health, and so much more. Most important of all, our focus is our residents. To ensure we are serving our residents in the best ways possible, we strive to be transparent and accessible. It is something we take seriously. In an effort to connect better with our residents, we recently launched Facebook and Twitter. We're a little behind the game, but we're glad that we're finally here. We believe it is important to be accountable and responsive and to consistently work to engage with our residents in as many ways as possible. Social media allows us to engage with our residents, receive timely feedback, and better inform people about our services and our events. So far, we've had some early success. Our social media presence is still growing, and we do need your support. So please, if you get a chance, do check on Facebook or Twitter. We'd love to have those numbers grow as large as possible. And we can be found on Facebook at Dakota County County Government and at Twitter at Dakota County MN. I'd like to take some time to talk about some of our recent issues that are very important to our residents, including transportation, the County Transit Improvement Board, economic development, housing, community services, crime prevention, and some of our recent improvements to Lake Bilsby Dam. Our decision to leave CTIB, the five-county board created to fund regional transit, has certainly been in the news quite a lot in the last month. I want to take the time to explain some of our thinking behind our decision as a county board. We are choosing to leave CTIB to get the best return on investment. The graphic shown here shows Dakota County's return on investment is far less than other counties in our partnership. From 2008 to 2017, Dakota County taxpayers will have contributed $122.4 million in regional sales tax to CTIB. To date, Dakota County Transitways have received capital and operating grants totaling only $52.9 million, a 43% overall return on investment. This is much less of an overall average investment compared to the other CTIB counties. Dakota County taxpayers will have contributed more to transitway costs outside of our county than anywhere else, coming to the tune of $167 for every man, woman, and child in Dakota County is what is going outside of our county for other transitways. That level of subsidy to the rest of the region is just not justifiable. We want to get the best investment for our taxpayers, and we feel that leaving CTIB will help us do that. We hope to reach a resolution with the other CTIB counties and adopt a quarter-cent sales tax, county-level transportation sales tax. The new tax will fund transportation improvements and projects solely in Dakota County and give our residents a better return on investment. If this moves to the legislature, then we will support, we'll seek support of our delegation. In our county, where all transit runs on roads, and with our growing population, we are demanding more highway miles, and we continue to rely heavily on our robust county road system. We are continuing to develop the transportation system. It is a top priority for the Board of Commissioners. We maintain 412 miles of county roads that are used by residents to travel more than a billion miles a year. We spend nearly $70 million a year. We will spend over $70 million a year over the next 5 years on highway projects alone. However, even with this, we will have a $500 million in unmet county highway needs between now and 2030. We want to use the money generated in Dakota County to meet our unique transportation system and our transit needs. The new Cedar Grove online station will be opening this May, which will significantly reduce travel times on Metro Red Line Cedar Avenue Rapid Transit Way. Other important projects include in 2017 the reconstruction of Trunk Highway 52 and County Road 42 interchange in Rosemont. The reconstruction of Trunk Highway 55 and Argenta Trail in Invergrove Heights is also another major project happening in 2017. We are developing efficient transit options that reduce road congestion and offering convenient alternatives to driving. Between now and 2030, plans call for adding 30 miles of new county highway and future transit routes, including the new Metro Orange Line connecting Lakeville and Burnsville to Minneapolis and extending Metro Red Line further south. These are currently limited transit options that we have in Dakota County, particularly our east-west corridors, making it challenging for those traveling east and west in Dakota County. To improve transit options, we conducted the East-West Transit Study, which evaluated transportation and transit needs. We are nearing the completion of the study, which has identified several corridors as priorities for future transit service expansion. We look forward to working with our service partners in the coming year to begin the implementation of expanded service on these corridors. Now I'd like to show a real quick video of our East-West Transit Study and what we can offer for residents.
Of the Twin Cities' major counties, Dakota County is unique in its blend of urban, suburban, and rural communities. It's a diverse mix we're proud of, but it also means that access to public transit varies in some locations.
Right now they're pretty strongly developed. There's further out areas which, you know, we don't have any transit service today in.
We're committed to improving transit access countywide, which is why we recently took an in-depth look at where and how our residents want to see expanded offerings.
We cast kind of a broad net with us. We're looking at the whole northern half of the county.
The East-West Transit Study focused on 15 major corridors. By gathering feedback online and through a series of open houses, we've come up with a list of recommendations to be included in a final report that will be issued shortly. Our hope is that those recommendations spur a transit expansion that increases access to area employers and helps aging residents stay connected to the community.
Overarching goal is to improve service quality and service access to the population in Dakota County, in particular those who tend to rely more on transit and those who in the future might need transit more.
So what's next? We will be working with our local transit operators to begin implementing the recommendations from this study in consideration of overall transit service needs in the effort to best serve the needs of our transit riders.
Transportation is a valuable tool for supporting economic development. When it comes to the economy in Dakota County, there's a lot to feel good about. The county unemployment rate dropped from 8% in 2010 to around 3% today, lower than both the national and state levels. The unemployment rate in Dakota County has frequently remained below the state and national averages during the last several years. Wages and income have also been growing gradually, and property values and new construction are increasing. More people are moving into Dakota County, pushing the county's population to more than 417,000 people. Challenges remain, but trends are positive. One challenge we are working on is providing affordable housing to our residents. We partner with the Dakota County Community Development Agency to provide affordable housing to low-income residents and seniors. The CDA has more than 30 programs to assist residents and businesses, making it one of the largest housing and community development agencies in the state of Minnesota. The housing programs provide more than 2,700 homes to keep families that qualify for assistance off the streets and give residents access to jobs. The CDA will open up its 29th senior community this summer with the addition of Argonne Hills in Lakeville. This locally funded initiative provides affordable housing for nearly 1,800 senior households. The rental market in the county is tight and market rate rents continue to outpace incomes. Meeting workforce housing needs in the county will continue to require resources and community support. Along with supporting a healthy economy, we take steps to empower and improve the lives of our most vulnerable residents. Dakota County's leadership in this area is absolutely critical to the success of the county as a whole. We are increasingly concerned about the lack of available resources in parts of our county that are facing social, economic, and housing pressures. On any given day in Dakota County, we have 161,000 open cases in community service that help children, seniors, those with disabilities, and those with mental and chemical health issues. We have areas of poverty and concentrations of unemployment. These areas are often poorly served by federal, state, and metropolitan funding streams. We are working hard to address disparities by raising awareness and investing in county programs that serve the less fortunate. One of the main roles of county government is to support everybody so they can reach their full potential. As part of our Pathways for Opportunity program, we are engaging communities throughout the county to understand the full range of community strengths, needs, and goals of our residents. In particular, we are working to better understand where we can add value, provide support, enhance our partnerships, and help remove barriers, starting in South St. Paul. Our Birth to Age 8 initiative has been very successful. This early childhood program, designed to assure increased educational success with at-risk populations, is emerging as a state model for coordinating multiple early childhood services. These are only some of the many services we provide behind the scenes to ensure that everyone in the county has the opportunity to thrive. Making sure our communities are thriving also means keeping our residents safe. A lot of work goes into that, and a lot more than we are traditionally aware of. There are many challenges law enforcement for Dakota County and around the nation face on a daily basis. The Dakota County Sheriff's Office is committed to preventing and reducing crime supporting crime victims, and becoming a community partner. The Sheriff's Office responded to nearly 25,000 calls for service in 2016, a slight increase over 2015. We have continued to fight crimes in various ways, including through advanced technology and investigative techniques. The recently formed Dakota County Electric Crimes Task Force won the county's Heroes Award this year for their efforts in electronic crimes and gathering digital evidence for criminal cases. The task force worked on over 260 cases in 2016, a more than 37% increase from the previous year. We are proud of all the work the task force does on a daily basis. While the Sheriff's Office is working on a variety of tools to fight and prevent crime, we are also working with the Sheriff, County Attorney, Community Corrections, Social Service staff, and the Judiciary to make sure offenders with mental health needs are connected to the right services so that they can stay out of the jail and be productive members of our society. I'd like to share a second video with you detailing our Adult Detention Alternatives Initiative and some of the work the Sheriff's Office is doing to help those in need.
From the moment they're booked into the Dakota County Jail, the clock starts ticking down until inmates re-enter the community.
This is jail, not prison, so they're only there from 5 to 10 days on average.
The goal is always to never have to see them behind these bars again, and a newer initiative is taking extra steps to set inmates up for success when they exit the jail.
We work together with community services. I think we'll be better off in that we have less mentally ill coming into the jail.
We're calling it the Adult Detention Alternatives Initiative, or ADAI for short. The aim is to better identify inmates' needs when they're booked into the jail and help connect them with the services and support they need to live productive lives when they re-enter the community. Mental health is a major focus of this effort.
To be better educated and understanding of the breadth and depth of mental illness in our communities, and then try to get these people into situations where they can get help, short of going to jail.
Sheriff Tim Leslie recently hired a mental health practitioner who is now working regularly with the jail's inmates to help target their specific needs. And he's pushing for Dakota County to follow London's example and start pairing officers with mental health practitioners to respond to calls in the field related to mental illness.
So they work together hand in hand to try to facilitate as much care and treatment to an individual in the community.
Another important project and the top legislative priority for the Dakota County Board of Commissioners is an effort to replace the century-old turbines and aging powerhouse at Lake Bilsby Dam, which is 100% owned by Dakota County. The dam is on the border of Dakota and Goodhue counties, but as I said, is maintained solely by Dakota County. Dakota County has recently invested over $6 million of taxpayer dollars to meet federal requirements and keep the dam safe. The county plans to repay taxpayers with the electricity's revenues generated, but maintenance costs are much higher than the revenue from the underutilized and inefficient turbines. We are asking the legislature for $7.5 million in matched local resources to help replace the turbines and powerhouse. A turbine replacement would reduce the maintenance cost by over 60% and double the capacity of clean renewable energy produced. The revenue from the increased revenue would offset the burden to the county taxpayers and preserve the dam while keeping it safe. We really look forward to making these improvements and would really appreciate any support that you can give. In 2016, we saw major growth in a number of our programs, including our parks, library system, and volunteer programs. And in the next couple slides, I'm going to share a little bit of some of our successes in 2016 with each of these programs. Our volunteer program is really taking off. I don't know, by a show of hands, is anyone in the room actually a volunteer with Dakota County? I know we have a couple people who volunteer. Thank you for all that you do and your support with that. We saw more than a 50% increase in volunteerism in 2016 with the number of hours of volunteering. And that amount of saved the county quite a lot of money. More than 2,000 volunteers put in over 39,000 hours of their time last year, which saved the county an estimated $921,000. Those impressive numbers are a result of a lot of hard work from a dedicated group of volunteers. Our volunteer program partners also partner with state and national organizations. We can continue to look forward to the good things with our volunteer program. We are excited to be celebrating our 50th anniversary of the Dakota County Park System in 2017. Our first acquisition of land was in 1967 of 80 acres around Jensen Lake, just off of Pilot Knob Road in Lebanon Hills Regional Park. At that time, much of the land inside and around the park was minimally developed. More than 40 separate land purchases have occurred since the inception of the initial acquisition. We look forward to celebrating our beautiful and diverse park system with all of you. Park staff have been at work determining the best ways to improve the overall park experience, as well as the natural resource management. Staff have been drafting the Park Visitor Service Strategic Operations Plan and the Natural Resource Management System Plan to help with these efforts. I encourage you to go online to the Dakota County website to learn more about these plans and provide your feedback. We are also looking forward to the grand opening event for the new 4.3-mile section of the Mississippi River Regional Trail through Spring Lake Park Reserve. The trail, which connects Spring Lake to the city of Hastings, has been open since November. I encourage all of you to attend our grand opening on May 20th from 9 until noon, which is promising to be a very exciting event. Now I'd like to share a video regarding the details of some of our park system.
It's a milestone year for Dakota County Parks. 2017 marks the system's 50th anniversary. From miles and miles of hiking trails to kayaking and cross-country ski equipment, we offer recreation opportunities for everyone.
It helps in terms of living well and healthy, both mentally and physically.
What started as an 82-acre park system in 1967 has since expanded to more than 5,500 acres. Initially, the system served about 20,000 people each year. Now, more than 1 million park users visit us annually.
10 years ago, we were serving around 800,000 people, so about a 40% increase over the past decade.
We're committed to providing the best parks experience possible to all our visitors, which is why this year we're completing 6 projects to improve Lebanon Hills, our largest park. That includes adding ADA-accessible trails to portions of the campus.
It will serve people that currently aren't using the park, that it will also accommodate those that may be less abled, and that it will provide for more diverse recreation.
And because we love our parks, we're taking major steps to ensure their future prosperity. In the last 3 years, we've expanded our fight against invasive species. We went from 540 acres under active management to more than 2,000 acres.
There's an array of invasives within the park system, and there's an array of best management practices, and Dakota County is starting to employ many of them.
All of these efforts mean that Dakota County Park's next 50 years will likely be even better than our first 50.
Another one of our growing programs and great successes in 2016 was our efforts to keep up with the needs of residents to offer better educational opportunities. We opened up an iLab makerspace at the Westcott Library in 2016. The iLab offers everyone a chance to design, create, and imagine projects of all kinds using state-of-the-art technology in video and audio production, creative design, 3D printing, and more. If you haven't had an opportunity to check out the iLab, please get over to Westcott and see the amazing technology that is now at our fingertips. In the first 5 months of operation, more than 1,300 hours were reserved for equipment use. Transforming libraries into community centers of the 21st century gives everybody an opportunity and a chance to learn and be inspired. The library now offers Hoopla, a digital service that presents a large selection of digital movies and TV shows, music, audiobooks, ebooks, and comics. Hoopla use in the first year grew by 77% with almost 8,000 checkouts in December alone of 2016. Visitors are now able to check out launch pads, which are tablets that contain educational games. More than 4.5 million items were checked out from the libraries in 2016. There were more than 1.8 million in-person visits to the library, and over 95,000 people attended programs and events with nearly 6,500 hours volunteered. This shows the great demand from residents for all the educational services our library offers. We are proud of the things we accomplished in the 2016, and we're going to build upon that success. In addition to what I've already discussed, the Board of Commissioners has several other key priorities. In early winter, we went and had our strategic planning session to start with the next 5 years of what the next initiatives for the County Board will be. As you saw in one of the earlier videos, improving the response to people with mental and chemical health needs by developing alternative responses to jail and increasing opportunity services is one of our priorities. Establishing a vision for the Dakota County 2040 comprehensive plan by revising and updating goals and priorities. Improving the election process in Dakota County along with cities, townships, and school districts. This will mean ensuring convenient access for voters, providing accurate and timely results, and communicating in a timely manner. Assisting the business community in meeting recycling mandates and helping the community, the county, make progress towards our 75% recycling goal by 2030 is another priority and initiative the board will be focused on. Continuing efforts to advance governance reform of the Metropolitan Council. Improving our capital facilities to meet the current growing transportation, parks, fleet, and public safety needs will be our ongoing and continuing priority for 2017. In conclusion, I would like to thank you for allowing me the opportunity to share just a few examples of the work we are doing. Dakota County is a great place to live, work, and play. We are stewards of the visionary work of those who came before us. On behalf of my fellow commissioners, I can assure you that we take that responsibility very seriously. The Dakota County Board and county employees look forward to building upon this county's great legacy and continuing to work with all of you and all of the citizens to ensure Dakota County continues to lead as one of America's best places to live, work, and play. Thank you, and now I'd like to open up the discussion for any questions or